Hi, welcome to my talk on our paper Complexity of Liveness in Parameterized Systems. This is joint work with Roland and Prakash. So we have seen two talks already on verification this day, and it seems that verification is actually a hard problem. It's a bit like climbing a mountain. So, and there are tons of tools that actually perform very well for verification tasks. So let's represent them by something that is very good in climbing mountains. For instance, an ibex. On the other side, we know that these problems have very hard worst case complexity. So when we put it on that, it's more like this, like pushing a stone up the hill. So why is this the case? So what tools can do is they use additional structure of examples or instances and parameters for their optimization. This worst case complexity is measured in a very rough thing, namely the input size only. So why don't we take the parameters that are used by the tools and measure the complexity of the verification tasks in these instead? And this is where track A comes into picture. So I will give a short introduction on parameterized complexity. This is what we use. So what is parameterized complexity? It is the analysis of parameterized problems. Well, what is a parameterized problem? It looks like a usual decision problem. So we have an instance, input, and a question. The input consists of an instance, like in classical complexity theory, and a list of parameters. And these parameters are used to describe the structure of the instance in more detail. And the question that we pose is, does the instance satisfy a certain parameter-dependent condition? So everything that is related to parameter is marked blue here. Okay, and the goal of this is we want to measure the influence of the parameters on the problem's complexity more precise. So we want to identify parameters that make the problem hard or parameters that allow for the construction of fast algorithms. So there's a special class of parameterized problems. It's called the fixed parameter tractable problems. They are almost solvable in polynomial time, up to parameters. Okay, what does that mean? We say a parameterized problem is fixed parameter tractable, or short FPT, if it has an algorithm that runs in time f of k times poly n. F is a computable function that only depends on the parameter. So this is the only part, I mean, where a non-polynomial blow-up happens. The rest, or the remaining part, is a polynomial in the input size n. So it really only depends polynomially on n and exponentially or more on the parameter k. And the idea is if the parameter k is small in practice, then we obtain a fast algorithm. And usually the running time of such problems is dominated by this f of k, so we denote it by O star f of k. Okay, so we are interested in the precise values of such an f, and this is usually referred to as fine-grained analysis. So let's assume we have a problem that is FPT and is solvable in O star f of k. Then what can such a f be? It can, for instance, look like the following. It's either 2 power k, 2 power root k, k power k, can be anything. The natural question is, once we have such a k, such an f, is there a smaller one that we can find? And finding a smaller f means we have to find a faster algorithm for the problem. The other way is there a least f that we need to solve the problem? There are also approaches to this, and this is finding lower bounds. There's something called the exponential time hypothesis that is a standard assumption used for lower bounds. And intuitively, this provides us with some sort of speed limits, namely, in that case, 2 power small o of k. And this, this excludes some of the f's that we have here. For instance, 2 power root k and 2 power k divided by log k would be excluded from the list. So we would know that we need at least, for instance, 2 power k or 1.4 power k. This would still work. And what we are interested in is we want to find the optimal f. So in fact, we want fast algorithms, but sometimes we cannot avoid having a lower bound. So we applied this to a problem called leader-contributor liveness. So the leader-contributor model is we have a leader thread, and we have a shared memory, and we have identical contributor threads. So can be arbitrarily many. Both leader and contributors have read and write access to shared memory, and we model the whole thing by non-deterministic finite automaton NFAPL for the leader. We have a memory cell D with some initial value A0, and we have a family of identical contributors. So these are modeled by NFA's PC. They all look the same. Then leader and contributors can read, this is marked by the question mark B, or write, exclamation mark B, from or to the memory. And this model is parameterized. So this parameterized is different parameterized than in the complexity world. This parameterized means the number of contributor threads, it's not a constant number. We don't know it precisely. We only know it's fixed, but it's arbitrary from the beginning. This is also different from dynamic thread creation. So the number is fixed a priori, but I mean, can be arbitrarily many. And then a leader contributor system consists of the domain, the initial value, the leader, and the contributor. Okay. So how does this work? What is the semantics of this model? We have the leader. Let's assume it looks like this. So it reads A, it reads B, and it can write C. And we have a contributor, PC, this is marked green, which looks like this. Okay. Now, the space of configurations in this case, let's assume we have one contributor, is the states of the leader times the domain of the memory times the state of the contributor. And the computation, for instance, looks like the leader is currently in Q0, the current memory value is A0, the initial value. The current position of the contributor is P0. Now, the contributor can write A to the memory and move to P1. It's that transition. Now, the memory value changes from A0 to A because he has written A to the memory. Now, the leader can actually read A and move to Q1. This would be that transition. Now, if we add a second contributor, let's mark it orange, then the space of configurations will change. So now we will have two components for the states of the contributors. And it works as expected, I mean, like before. Let's, for instance, assume the green contributor writes A to the memory, then we move to that configuration with current memory value A. Now the leader can read A. Then the next contributor writes B to the memory. Now the leader can actually read B. And then the leader can write C to the memory, and both contributors can now move back to their initial state. And actually, we can loop in this configuration. So we can repeat the whole process. Now, for this model under the semantics, we look at the liveness problem. What is liveness, or what do I mean with liveness in this context is, can the leader repeatedly reach a final state? So formally, we're given as input a leader contributor system S and a set of final states F of the leader. And the question is, does there exist a computation such that a final state in this computation sigma occurs infinitely often? I mean, the usual repeated reachability problem. The problem is known to be NP-complete since 2015. And we perform a parameterized complexity analysis for this problem in the parameters of the corresponding reachability problem that was investigated last year. So what are these parameters? So first of all, we look at the states or the number of states of the leader. This is the first parameter. We look at the size of the domain, and we look at the number of states of the contributor. So these are the three parameters that we look at, and we want FPT algorithms for these. And it turns out that I mean, the two most interesting parameterizations are first by the states of the leader and the size of the domain, and the second by the states of the contributor. So what are the results? First of all, we prove some sort of meta theorem that says we can divide the liveness problem into a reachability and cycle finding problem, like it is also the case for many other systems. And the liveness problem, LCL, can be solved in time reach times cycle. So reach is the time we need to solve the reachability problem. Cycle is the time we need to solve the cycle detection problem. So we are solving LCR, the reachability problem, and we solve the cycle finding problem. And it was already known that LCR can be solved in 2 power C last year. This was also proven to be optimal. What we did in the paper is we looked at the other parameterization in LND and solved it in L plus D, O of L plus D, and proved it to be optimal. And we also solved the cycle finding problem. And surprisingly, this was possible in polynomial time. This is roughly a fixed point iteration mixed with Tarchan's algorithm for finding SECs. Okay, and if we put things together, so we can, I mean, combine it with this meta theorem to get an algorithm for LCL, one that runs in 2 power C, the other one that runs in L plus D power O L plus D. And this is also optimal because the lower bounds from the reachability problem actually carry over to the liveness problem. And for the remaining talk, I will give you a slight intuition of how the algorithm for that theorem actually works. Okay, so we solve the reachability problem now. What is the reachability problem? We're given, like in the liveness problem, a leader contributor system and a set of final states F. And we want to know whether there's a computation sigma such that in the configuration that I reach, C, the leader is in a final state. So pi LZ is just a projection to the component of the leader. Also, this problem is NP complete. And there's a deterministic algorithm from last year that runs in L times D power O L times D. This algorithm is basically an iteration over witnesses. A witness is just a short form of representing a run. Instead of an iteration, what we did is we did a dynamic programming, and we did not work with witnesses directly, we worked with short witnesses, and these two ingredients were enough to get a better running time. Okay, so what are witnesses? Witnesses are actually there for one thing: to make computations short again. Okay, so what is the leader doing during a computation? Well, the leader runs through some states, Q1, Q2, Q3, until it ends in some state Q. Then let's assume we have two contributors, namely a green one that does something and an orange one that also does something. Okay. Now, the first step to obtain a witness is we project the computation just to the run of the leader and we ignore reads. So what do I mean by that? Well, the first step is the leader starts in Q1 and writes an A. So we put Q1, A. It goes to Q2 and reads a B. The only thing that we remember is it goes to Q2 and it read something. So we just put a bottom symbol there. Then it is in Q3 and writes C. We mark that and so on. And the run of the leader ends actually in state Q. Now, what we remember from the contributors is only the first write positions. A first write is when a value of the memory is written for the first time by a contributor. This happens here with write B, let's say when the leader is actually in state Q2, and it happens here, write D, when the leader is in Q4. Why is this important? Well, first writes are important because once a contributor has provided a certain symbol, we can assume an arbitrary number of contributors providing this symbol. This is the power of this parameterized model. This is also called the copycat lemma. So we can actually assume that whenever I need this symbol for the leader, it is just there. There is some contributor that can provide it. Okay, and remembering these positions of the first writes is just a map from one to the number of first writes into the witness. Okay, and the witness in short is the word W, so let's just put it as WQ sigma. Okay, so having such a witness, when does it actually correspond to an actual computation? This is something that we have to define. Let's assume we have this witness. So the second thing that we did when representing a runs by witnesses is we forgot about the precise values of the first write. We only mark positions, right? So the first thing that we need is so-called first write sequences. These are just sequences of distinct data values. And now we can define it along this sequence beta. So X is valid. So valid later means it corresponds to an actual computation. X is valid if it is leader valid and contributor valid. Okay, so what does this mean? Leader valid means the witness actually encodes a proper run of the leader. So whenever there's a write in the witness, there's also a transition in the leader. Whenever there's a read, and this is not a point, the read is from an earlier first write. This is why we remember the first writes. Okay, and then we call this L valid beta of X. Then we can do the same thing for the contributor. So the contributors have to provide the first writes at certain positions. This is what we have to ensure. And this is exactly what contributor validity is. So I will not go into too many details here. One thing that we need to ensure is that we can provide all the reads that the contributor needs to provide the first write in the end. And this is mentioned as C valid. And together, this is just called validity. Of course, there's a criterion for this then. There exists a computation that leads to a final state if and only if there is a witness and a first write sequence beta such that X is valid along beta. Okay, this validity is something that we can evaluate in polynomial time. So the first idea for an algorithm would be, yeah, let's just iterate over all witnesses and first write sequences and just evaluate valid beta. One can do this, but this is too slow. This is expensive. A better idea is to change the notion of witnesses a bit. So in fact, we will switch to short witnesses. And this will be done by somehow cutting out loops that appear in the witness itself. So if it looks like this, then we know the leader runs in a loop from Q1 to Q4. It's actually the same state. So why not cutting out this loop and just obtain Q1 and we immediately go to Q5 then? And the only thing that we need to ensure is that the first writes that appear on the loop will now appear on the state where the loop starts and ends. Okay, so in a short witness, the leader states are distinct. I mean, something we can define. The only thing that we have to prove now is that validity is somehow compatible with this shrinking. I mean, it has to be compatible with the short, with the notion of short witnesses now. How do we ensure this? Well, a witness X is always the product of short witnesses. Okay, so this is a witness, rather long, and we just mark the runs from sigma 1, for instance, to sigma 2 by x2, for sigma 2 to sigma 3 by x3. These are all short witnesses. There's no point between first writes for the leader to run in a loop. So actually, we have that x, the whole witness, is the product of x1 up to xl, where each xi is the run between two first writes. Now, assume we already know that the run x1, x2, x3 is L valid, so it's a proper run of the leader. Now, we want to know whether, when we append x4, is this still a proper run of the leader. And the problem is that this y is not a short witness. This y can be very long. So what is happening on the leader in x1, x2, x3, or in y? So it is some run on the leader. And now we know that beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, they occur during this run at some point. We want to append x4, the green run, and we want to know whether is this still a proper run on the leader. And the only thing that we need to remember for this is we already know till this state it is already a proper run, but there's no point in remembering this loop. I mean, we can just cut it out. This is nothing that we need to remember when we check for leader validity. We can just cut this out and see, yeah, actually, this is a proper run if and only this is a proper run. So what we get from this is that we can actually shrink this y and test leader validity on this instead. The advantage of this is that these two witnesses are actually short again. So this allows us to check this leader validity inductively on short witnesses. Okay, so the same thing, a bit more involved, can be done for contributor validity. And one can turn this into a recursion, which we can then solve via dynamic programming. So what is happening here is we define the notion of short validity. So we have to define when a short witness is actually valid. And what we do is we have a short witness set. We split this into two witnesses, X and Y. So we have X and Y. And intuitively, X is the run from beta 1 to beta I minus 1, and Y is the rest. And both are short. Then we test whether the product X and Y is L valid. This can be done in polynomial time. We test whether the product is contributor valid. This can also be done in polynomial time. We only have to ensure, now we work only on short witnesses. We only have to ensure that the remaining part, X, is also short valid again. So we get rid of this Y. And this is precisely the recursion that we need. And the criterion that we saw before for validity carries over to the notion of short validity. And the algorithm for computing this recurrence or recursion is we come up with a table. The table is indexed by set, all short witnesses, and beta 1 up to beta I, all data sequences or all first write sequences. And we fill this table up, for instance, bottom up. And then the complexity is the number of short witnesses times the number of first write sequences. This is the number of entries. And computing an entry is just this branching over short witnesses. And this gets us the running time that we actually wanted. Thank you.
What do you gain from this result? So are there any clues where you have a nice explanation why they work well, or some application where you have a nice explanation why you check? Or
The first thing is that we see insight, or we have insights into this combinatorial nature of this verification task that has not been there before. So, of course, it is a theoretical study. We did not implement this. But I think we do understand too less about this kind of problems. And we just gain more theoretical and also combinatorial insights for this. So this does not directly explain why tools work well. But it is a first hint to this direction, I would say.
But are there any tools that you can look at?
Are there any tools?
For the setting of leader contribution.
There are tools for parameterized verification, right? And they should also be capable of implementing this model.
Anything known about the case where you have more than one shared variable?
Okay, the shared variable, let's say we have some number, then we can, of course, always go to the product domain. And as long as this number is constant or not too large, these things will still apply. When you have too many variables, though, I would guess that all of this becomes p-space complete, the problem.
If you do not have an arbitrary number of identical processes, but you limit the number of processes, it looks like it's a simple problem, but I think it's p-space complete in that case. You say I would like to have no more than some contributor, given number of contributors to the binary. Do you think that your approach can be applied in order to obtain good algorithm for this p-space?
Or the p-space complete problems.
Yes.
Okay, usually this FP for NP complete problems, but of course if you think about problems like QBF, there would also be a 2 power K algorithm, right? So, okay, this I would have to think about for longer, I would say. Maybe for some of these problems it would work. There would also be interesting parameters for p-space complete problems.
Thank you, Steve.